Well, g'day, Vanessa. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Pete. I'm very glad to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad to have you on. Now, you are a very different guest than what I've normally had because you're 16 and you've started a business.
Yeah, that's correct.
So could you tell me, just tell me about your business. What's the story there?
Well, I help people by giving them recipes. So people with intolerances and things like that, so mainly gluten intolerance, and if they don't like eating sugar and stuff, I have sugar-free recipes and stuff like that.
Okay, so how did you come up with that as a business?
Well, I'm gluten intolerant myself, and my mother has been for years, and I'm really interested in helping other people learn about how we integrate this into our everyday lifestyle and showing them how easy it can be to enjoy your healthy food.
Okay, so you, how did you come up with the different recipes? Were they just different things you tried that you thought were really good and you sort of changed them around? Tell me a bit about how you did the come up with those recipes.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what I've done, and just experimenting and seeing what I like and what my peers like and my family like, and I've adapted a few recipes, so classics and stuff, to make them healthy and gluten-free, and yeah.
So what? Let me ask you this then. So what are some of the problems with being in your situation and the food that you normally would eat had you not come up with some good recipes? What's it like living that way?
Well, a lot of gluten-free recipes are really bland and boring, and they can get really repetitive on a daily basis. So my main plan is to make really exciting, tasty food. And a lot of gluten-free foods, people don't realize how unhealthy they are because they've got a lot of other added nasty stuff, like lots of sugar and stuff. So all of my recipes are completely gluten-free and sugar-free.
Okay.
And, yeah, that just helps with eating out anywhere, and it gives you so much more – you're so much more open to eating different gluten-free foods. And yeah.
So with the sweet stuff, then, if you're not putting sugar in, how are you making sweet food? What do you use for sweetener?
Some of the foods I don't use any sweetener. Like if they're fruit-based, like I've got some pancakes and stuff, I don't put any sugar in them. I just put fruit in them.
Okay.
Or I put in honey or agave nectar.
Ah, so you're using actual just sweet foods that, yeah, they're naturally sweet. Okay. So could you tell us some of the recipes? Like what are some of the recipes that you've come up with?
Well, I've got sugar-free banana pancakes, and I do everything. So dinners, spaghetti bolognese, and stir fries, ice creams, any recipe you can think of. Really, I've got so many.
Okay. Oh wow! How long have you been working on these recipes then? If you've got so many.
Well, I've been cooking all my life. Like I was getting up on Sunday mornings to make pancakes, gluten-free pancakes, since I was seven.
Yeah.
But I've really been putting them together for my business since about March this year.
Okay. So let's talk about the business side of things. Now, when I was 16, all I could think about was learning how to play guitar and hanging out with my friends. So it's not the average 16-year-old that goes out and says, I'm going to make a business. So what sort of prompted that for you?
Well, I think it's really getting out of the circle I'm in and looking at the situation people are in at the moment with the global financial crisis and things like that. I want to be able to explore the world and take every opportunity I can and learn different languages and stuff. And I think I can have that freedom by being self-employed. And what I know how to do well is cook healthy, exciting meals. And I thought, I could help other people learn how to become healthier and actually enjoy what they're eating every day. And yeah, that's, I just want to help people.
That's excellent. And what I really like about that is that you're combining something you're passionate about, you're interested in, that helps you, that you went, hey, I want to share this with other people, and then come up with an idea about creating a business. Now, have you had any kind of help with someone sort of helping you with your business? How is your business structured? Like, is it an online thing? Is it, you know, do parties, or you know, how does your business work?
It's predominantly online. I've got my own website, and I advertise through Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I sell my recipes in ebook format, and I blog about them, and I have different information about how to dye your hair naturally and all about just natural well-being and things like that. So I advertise that way, and I also do some network marketing at business courses and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Well, that's top. So I'm inspired that you've started so young, because I'm sitting here thinking, oh, gee, I wish I had that mindset when I was that young. Now, as far as the business goes, the website and all that sort of stuff, what are you doing? Because you go to school. So when do you find time to, because I imagine you're probably pretty busy with schoolwork as well and homework and all that kind of things. How do you find time to actually do stuff in your business? Do you have a methodology behind that? You have like an hour a day, 2 hours a day, or you know, every second day? How does that work for you?
Well, I've just started the Year 12 course, so I do have a lot of work going on with that. But I try to keep a balance. So I'll do like an hour a day. So I'll do a few Facebook posts and Twitter posts and things like that. And then on the weekends, I might do half of each day. I'll do a blog post, and then I have conference calls 3 times a week. So they're an hour each. So I do those. And the days I have two days at school where I have free study periods. So on those days I'll do 2 hours of work, but it's just really finding a balance. So when I have a big break in school, I'll cram in loads more business stuff.
Yeah. So are you constantly, now let me ask you, are you constantly thinking about your business stuff rather than, if you're sitting there, you're meant to be doing homework, does your brain drift off to the business stuff?
They're both going on simultaneously, really. But yeah, every time now I'm at school, I'm like, oh, we could sell that idea. Or I have an idea at school about different recipes. I'll write it down in my English book and things like that.
Excellent. I love it. I love it. So what's your website? If people want to go find out and go and get some of your recipes, where do they go?
You can visit the website at lovefoodlivefree.com.
Mm-hmm.
And I've also got a Facebook page, which is Love Food Live Free, and you can follow my Twitter, which is Vanessa Harley 79. And yeah, so jump on there and have a look at my ebooks and things like that, and follow my blog posts.
Excellent. Well, thanks so much. You've been an incredible guest, and you've just brought a smile to my face. You've just like capped off an excellent day. Thank you so much for coming on and sharing that with us.
Oh, thank you very much, Pete.
And see ya.
Bye.
Well, g'day, Kerry. Welcome to the show. It's great to have you on in the day of the life of you, your business on Facebook. Could you quickly tell us who are the clients that you're working with? What are the types of people you're working with?
First of all, thanks, Pete, for having me. It's really nice to see you. The clients that I'm working with are parents of young children, so from birth to 5 years of age. My background is early childhood health, so I'm basically a baby health nurse, and I help people with any sort of problems that they have with their children, so feeding, sleeping, and postnatal depression as well.
Okay, and specifically, how are you helping these mums? I guess it's mainly mums you'll be working with, so yeah, how are you helping them?
It is mainly mums. There are some dads there as well. And basically what I'm finding now is that parents are so isolated and find it really difficult to get really good information and good help quickly. And it's not very easy to access your early childhood services. and making an appointment with the baby health clinic is actually quite difficult after delivery for some people, particularly if they've had cesareans or don't have a car or those sorts of things. So through my program, which is Early Childhood Coach, I can actually access parents everywhere all around the world and give them information one-on-one through this wonderful medium of Skype.
Yeah, excellent. Oh, so you're completely comfortable in the whole Skype situation then.
Lovely. It's lovely. Yeah, that's right. And I've worked in this business for such a long time. I've been an early childhood nurse for 26 years and I've worked in wonderful places like Tresillian and Caratani. And from that, I've gathered so much information and realised that there are so many people that we're not actually helping, we're not actually getting to. And that's my passion, is to actually be able to help people that find it very difficult to access services live, actually in person. So.
Okay, because I remember, because I got four kids, so I'm very hip to the whole Tresillian scene. It was very helpful when we needed to be there. But yeah, but sometimes you just can't get that access. So that's really good that you can get to these women, can get to you a lot quicker.
Exactly right. And there's a lot of communities that are quite isolated. For example, communities that are involved in our services, so the Army and Air Force and Navy, those families often can be quite isolated and move around a lot, and it's very difficult for them to get a rapport with a great nurse or a great doctor that they can keep in contact with. So I can do that with those people as well.
Okay, so what would be the typical sort of issues that you get? So someone calls up, what are their problems that you're helping them solve?
Okay, it's the most common problem is sleeping or lack of sleep, as you probably know yourself. Very difficult to get little ones to go to sleep and to actually cope with the lack of sleep. So I can talk through different methods that we have, and everyone has an individual choice of the way they want to bring up their children. So my idea is to give people lots of education, let people know what is normal in sleep, what is normal to expect in your child's sleep, and to help people achieve goals, step-by-step little goals to achieve basically peace and harmony in the household.
Excellent. Okay, so I've interrupted you from your day, and this is a day in the life of what were you doing just before we had this call, say, like, you know, specifically with the work that you do?
I was actually just chatting to a mum who I've been seeing for quite a long time, and she's now has her second child, and she just contacted me to get some help with some breastfeeding problems. Okay. So, yeah, it's great.
Excellent. Okay, so do you have a website that people can go visit? And if you do, could you tell us what it is?
I do. It's all the W's, earlychildhoodcoach.com.
Simple. Excellent. Well, thanks so much for coming on the show, Carrie. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on.
Lovely. Thanks, Pete. Thank you for inviting me.
That's okay. See ya.
Bye.
Well, g'day, Marina. Welcome to the show. It's great to have you on.
Thanks, Peter.
So, Marina, could you tell us a little bit about the clients that you work with? Who are the people that you're working with at the moment?
Okay. My business is the Australian Consortium of Nannies, and it's basically a resource and information service. So I help nannies be the best nannies that they can be by providing them strategies and skills to work in their jobs, and then also helping parents just along the process of sourcing, selecting, screening and employing their nannies.
Okay, so, well, I've never heard of that as a role. Like, that's really interesting. How are you helping? How do you facilitate that situation, and how did you get into that?
Okay, my background is that I've actually been a professional nanny for the past 25 years. And when I fell pregnant with my firstborn, I actually started an agency. And through that, I realised I didn't really like working with the parents one-on-one when I had people who told me that they didn't want to pay superannuation for nannies and that they didn't want to pay their entitlements. I noticed that there was a huge turnover of nannies, and the main issue was communication, that we had young nannies who weren't used to talking to people who are in their 40s and 50s who are in quite you know, sort of strong and influential careers, and it can be a little bit intimidating when you're in your early 20s of how do you say, well, guys, you promised me a pay rise and it hasn't happened yet. So they'd actually leave and go to another job to obtain that pay rise.
Yeah.
So it's all those little glitches, and a lot of it comes down to communication, and that's the main cash flow point for my business, is either consulting one-on-one with parents, and it's also a guide that I've put together, the nanny organisers, so that parents can parents have a tool that they can communicate with their nannies, and they keep the lines open with each other. And there's only so much information you can exchange in 5 minutes where you've got kids climbing up you wanting mummy's attention when you get home. And
yeah.
So it makes it a little bit hard.
Okay. So you're saying that you who are your clients then mainly? Is it the nannies or is it the parents? Like, how are you dealing with the parents? Because they're the ones we're trying to get the money from. To pay the nannies properly. So how are you working with them? Are they hiring you to do that?
Yeah, with parents, I've often consulted over time, but I've just found that by putting together a little guide that I've used and sort of the forms and stuff that I'd used to keep communication open with my family, and I've handed it around to other nannies and it works. So I've just sort of streamlined that and packaged it together. And there's also a guide that's included in that for parents to help them through step by step through that process of selecting nannies. One of the ways that we need to educate the Australian community as a whole about what nannies actually are and what they do, that they don't go around sipping lattes and flying around on jets all the time and all those sorts of things. And, you know, the majority of our employers do not earn $1 million a year. The millionaires have 5 or 6 nannies. You know, the average family employs one nanny that works, if they're working full-time, they work for 50 hours a week. So to basically support and educate the girls on how to be great nannies, I've actually put together a digital magazine that's launching next Tuesday, which is really exciting. And okay. I went and invited 20 people to be interviewed, expecting maybe 5 to come back. But my little 30-page magazine is now blown out to over 100 pages.
Wow. So, what's it called? Yeah, what's it called?
Give it a plug. The Nanny Nest.
Sorry, I talked over you then.
You're right. It's called The Nanny Nest, and you can find it either on the nanniesaustralia.com.au website, or you can find it on Izzu, the issue.com, which is the it's ISSW.com. And it's one of the most easy ways that a business can put information out and really place yourself as being an industry expert and an industry leader by interviewing people, same as you do, and but putting it in print and putting some nice pictures and things in there. And it's something that's really accessible, and it's free, which is fantastic. You can have up to 500 pages in your magazine if you wanted to go that far. But yeah, just to put something together that's, you know, anywhere between 10 and 20 pages long, that it's enough to get that information across there. And it's something that's a little bit different from what other businesses are doing too.
Okay. And I just want to highlight, I just heard someone out there, so I think my family is about to rumble in the door, but that's okay. This is
It's school time.
School time, child-related interview. It all kind of connects, and it's, yeah, yes. Let's call it branding. No.
Yeah.
So, I've interrupted you in your day. You were doing what before I called you up?
I was in the middle of, I had actually sent off 6 of the interviews to be okayed by people who are being included in the magazine. And in addition to that, what I'll be doing this afternoon is basically going through my media list and sending out all the emails to the journalists saying, you have this misperception about the nanny industry. Here's a magazine that can actually all lay it out for you, because we've got, you know, sort of 23 different industry leaders and nannies that are included in the magazine. So it's just one way to be able to bring all the journos and all the people who do the writing about the nanny industry, to bring them back to my website and let them know that, yeah, Maureen is the person to talk to when you need to know about nannies and what's going on in the industry.
Okay, well, if people do need to know more about you, where do you want to send them?
Come over to nanniesaustralia.com.au, or you can find me on Facebook too under Nannies Australia. They'll be the main 2 places where I'll be hanging out from next Tuesday, which is great.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for coming on. You've been an awesome guest. And I never know what my guests are going to be like until they come on and we do this, and you've been great. Thanks for taking the time to share your information.
Thank you, Peter. It's been great. And can I just say, and Peter wasn't expecting this, I spent an hour on the phone once with Peter. I was shopping around looking for a business coach for a different project that I was doing. And Peter was the only person who would actually listen to what it was that I wanted to do. So often we're told, you know, go for the upper end of the market and charge people a fortune and not work with as many people. But Peter actually got where I was coming from, and I will return to that project down the track. So thank you very, very much for that, Peter, because you just, you know, you restored my faith in business coaches. So you're still on my to-do list to be doing in the next couple of months. So thank you very much.
Excellent. Well, thanks for that. That was completely unexpected, but I do remember that phone conversation, and yeah, I understand exactly what you're saying when, they always kind of gear you towards going for the biggest. Go for the big bucks, you know, but it's not always the way.
Yep, and these blokes that have made an awful lot of money out of selling shoelaces. So, you know, sometimes quantity is better.
Yeah, okay, thanks so much for coming on, and I really appreciate that little plug right there. That was awesome.
Thanks, Peter. Thanks. See you.
See ya.